For me, Paul Thomas Anderson's film The Master from 2012 is profoundly concerned with ways of seeing. It's concerned with that figuratively, in that it's very much a movie about a philosophical worldview, about taking control of one's life or maybe being subservient to some higher power. It's definitely got a social vision in that it depicts America in a kind of post-war period after World War II, a period that's often romanticized and idealized in terms of nostalgia, however much you want to make of the term, make America great again is when The Master is set, but it shows that it's a profoundly unequal society and a society that has a lot of people drifting along at the margins, including the character Freddie Quell, played by Joaquin Phoenix. But it's also a movie about point of view in that we often see what Freddie sees. Point of view shots aren't necessarily a famous part of Paul Thomas Anderson's arsenal. He tends to feature more objective, omniscient points of view. He likes to have the camera join multiple characters together in a space, like at the beginning of Boogie Nights or throughout Punch Drunk Love.
Sorry about that.
I didn't know you had a sister.
Yes, I do. I wanted to tell you guys about the new finders. We've been working on this, and we have a non-breakable handle, finally. Let me demonstrate for you. Okay, this was one of the old ones, so do we have a new one around, Lance? Sorry about that.
I think starting with Punch Drunk Love and extending through There Will Be Blood and The Master especially, he's more interested in psychic space. Physical space has almost become representations of characters' headspaces, and in The Master, we peer out from that headspace. And this becomes very apparent early in the film when Freddie, who's been discharged from the army, becomes a photographer at a department store.
You married?
Yes.
For your wife?
Pardon?
Is it for your wife?
Yes.
It's evident, having met him, that it's not a job he has a lot of facility for. He's not trained as a photographer. The incongruity of him taking these photos sort of suggests that he's just someone operating the camera. He doesn't have much skill for composition or for encouraging the patrons.
It's hot.
What he sees is interesting because he sees people who are not like him. He sees that post-war optimism. He sees that normalcy in a series of portraits that he takes of smiling, shiny, happy people who are in these very significant configurations, young couples, happy children, successful business people. It all calls attention, I'd say, to what he lacks.
Ready? Get thee we'll give a good smile. Me, Satan. I want to
resist, but the moon is low. Anderson makes this idea of point of view spectacular in the moment where, instead of taking photographs, he becomes distracted and quite mesmerized by a coworker at the mall, at the department store, who's this very tall, statuesque woman who's selling a coat. So she's like a walking commodity. She's like a walking advertisement for herself. And the camera becomes hooked to her and follows her on this sort of twirling series of pirouettes. And you can break it down and say that the camera work here is very much inspired by Max Ophuls, or the camera work is inspired by Stanley Kubrick. I mean, that's Anderson's film geek side. But it's so aligned with what Freddie sees. And it's not just that he wants her or that he's attracted to her. What she's passing by is just so suggestive. You see her pass by bridal wear, and then you see her pass by lingerie and the maternity ward. Like, it's a very funny visual joke suggesting what's on Freddie's mind, because this is someone who is this kind of consummation that he hasn't had or hasn't had sort of under normal circumstances. And so it's this very lyrical, rapturous, you know, erotic sequence. And it's so funny, too, because it's soundtracked by the song Get Thee Behind Me, Satan, which is a song all about mastering temptation. And the way that it's being sung by Ella Fitzgerald is the opposite of chaste. It's a very seductive vocal performance. The song has become ironized and kind of weaponized against its literal meaning. She's saying, I don't want to give in, but the music is suggesting the exact opposite. But that combination of character psychology, image, soundtrack, and choreography in the film, I think, is sublime. And it also cues later moments in the movie that you can think of, whether it's the first time Freddie sees the Cause's boat, the Alethea, docked in the harbor, when he imagines Philip Seymour Hoffman's Lancaster Dodd at the center of this orgy, where he's undressing all the women around Dodd with his eyes, even as he's watching Dodd whirl around like the woman in the department store. The scene with the shop girl creates this visual motif that runs through the rest of the movie just so elegantly. The idea in The Master of Freddie looking at women is embedded right from the beginning when he's on the beach and it's an abstract representation of a woman. And there's something about this sandcastle woman that's built, and it's very obviously metaphorical, I mean, it's not subtle, but there's something about her size in proportion to him, the way that she's sort of splayed out. She's this earth mother figure, and it's really interesting how it renders him kind of infantile at the same time that he's desiring her. So in the payoff to the shop girl sequence, where he actually does kind of bring her into the dark room and sort of fool around with her, the choreography is also very infantile. Like she exposes her breast and he's kind of grabbing at it, and it's almost more like he's a child than he's a lover.
Oh, tastes good.
And that continues to be at the root of his interactions with women, where he toggles between completely infantile behavior and kind of adolescent behavior, but sort of just a lack of maturity and even a kind of lack of completion and what he's able to do with them, which is why I think the way that she completely just fixes his attention is so fascinating. It's a expression of something you see in movies very often to the point of cliche, which is like, she's his dream girl. She's a dream girl. She's a dream representation. She's something that he sees, and it's mediated through the lens of a camera, which in a way makes it as much a fantasy as the photos he's taking of ordinary people. When he actually gets up close and personal with her, the reality is really disappointing. And there's a sort of, I think, funny joke in that too.